So, I never played a game in this series because I always liked how Wonder Boy was structured instead. And now, here we go! Well, I'm Arachne and I'm talking about...
Kirby's Adventure Island 2!
You forgot the super part?
Kirby's Adventure Island 2!
Okay, whatever you say. This is an action-adventure title, the continuation of the saga, but with totally different gameplay. We go full Wonder Boy, and I couldn't be happier. I dislike and didn't review the others because of the constant depleting of health that you have to fight against. None of that blues here. And the story feels detached enough from the rest of the series that you can understand what's happening without playing the others. Master Iggy and Sentina, just married, are going into a honeymoon. A classic beach island with resorts and everything, even a casino. Unfortunately, the place chosen has been under attack by a weird-looking magician and his bastard, so he steals Tina thinking she's the queen of the land. Both of them bonk their heads and forget who they are. Shit's going down here. You're basically forced to restore peace to the kingdom to get Tina back, because this Mario impostor looking slob can't enter the mountain range without the power of the elements. I like the reasons for exploration and everything. The story is reflected in the gameplay. Always a good feeling when that happens. Aside from the dialogue, it's extremely cheesy, and I'm usually impervious to cheese, but this time everything felt like a romantic B-movie from the 40s or 50s. Extremely strange to read this, especially out loud. But it's not in much in the way of the fun we're having. This game, the first time around, will take you at minimum 8 hours, probably quite more. The dialogue is around 20 minutes of reading, so it's nothing, but it's still pretty funny to see. So...
Kirby's Adventure Island 2!
Okay, but it's basically an action-adventure, full-on, with a world map and dungeons even if they're played by the side. Nothing that we haven't seen already, including in Dragon View. This time it's a bit more involving, not an RPG, but relying on, but not too much, skill. Controls-wise, you have all the usual stuff plus some new things to keep in mind, with the B button you jump, with Y you attack, and with X you open your main menu. Pretty standard for now, but then it introduces something unusual. The A button launches magic, but also functions as confirmation for menus, text, various stuff. And yeah, there's magic in this game. I'll briefly go over the ones that you actually need, because there's 8 of them, but only half have any use. The fly spell will send you to the beginning of a stage. Great when you get a new item and you're exploring around, so that you exit real quick and go back to the world map. The second one is a quick heal that only gives a bit of a full heart. It's an emergency thing, or you can use it to keep your full health. Not that having that gives you any bonus attack here, but you know, you might be like me. You could be obsessive about exploring with complete hearts. Anyway, after that you've got the wing spell. This is a teleport you can use from the world map that sends you to various locations, like the beginning of a level or to this type of health pool. Those, by the way, reminded me of the Kid Icarus games. And that was my first review on this channel. It's really true what they say. All game concepts started in the 8-bit era. The last one is the full recover, but I think this magic speaks for itself, no? You can ignore the rest, especially if you wanna win against the hardest bosses. Health is better than magic. What's most important, as typical for the genre, is your items and equipment. You've got an explorable world map with the main dungeons labeled above their entrance for ease of exploration, plus many extra locations, not really hidden, but you have to get there. And doing so might not be easy because this overworld is littered with random encounters. I really didn't enjoy those. You just have to reach one side of the screen to end them too. They serve no gameplay purpose. Just fluff to slow you down. Bad game design. But from the main menu, you can check the world map and see all the nook and crannies that are stashed here, just have to get there. Some places are more important for progressions, others are for exploring secret areas in the dungeons. I managed to get 100% on this game because it's not very hard to do so. The dungeons have pretty good layouts and many different locations and looks to them, so they're pretty distinctive and varied. But to help you further, you've got a stage map too, and it automaps. Not any references to important places on it, aside from the boss door. That square will flash different colors. Every place will have its own set of rules, types of puzzles unique to that dungeon, plus some recurring elements. But you'll not confuse them. They even introduce new concepts in the final one. That's pretty rare to see, especially in this era. And they are good to navigate, so the map doesn't need to be detailed after 1 hour in the same part of
Adventure Island 2.
You basically memorize it. Also, enemy variety was quite amazing. They always had one or more new fuckers and mixed with them easier stuff from previous areas. That good balance I love and appreciate. Bosses are kind of all over the place, unfortunately. The penultimate boss was the easiest one for me, for example. That shouldn't happen. Even if you can have some ups and downs, the last few should be the hardest ones. Even the final boss was not a good ramp up within itself. It had 5 phases and the first 3 were harder than the last 2. That's not ideal, no. There's a few secret ones and those are fine if they are easy. I actually prefer when developers put the most interesting fights in the main game instead of the side content, so that was a good choice. The casino I mentioned at the very beginning is real and it has 3 games in it. Even if I suggest doing only the slot machines, because the other 2 are very slow in terms of pace and reloading. Your reward? The best equipment in the game, so it's nothing to scoff at. Beware that it took me 5 hours to get all this, but it might take you more or less. It's all luck. What's lacking is something truly unique. It's all so well done, but only a few things have never been seen before. The most I can speak of in that regard is the button system. Each dungeon has its own and it activates specific blocks that each have a symbol on them. They will in turn block or open up access to different parts of this, but most things are pretty standard. Other than varied, they also look very pretty. The visuals help with taking away the generic feeling pretty well. Great sprites and amazing detail. That's all I ask when I get some 2D art and that I got. Honestly, there's also some fantastic Mod 7, most used for backgrounds and parallax scrolling, effects, different vibes, lots of views of so many colors. I already don't understand how they fit this much detail in a 1.5 MB cartridge and then you have high quality music too. With samples, those crazy composers did it, and really nice stuff. The game takes place in modern times, trademark, and so they do represent the music that was in trends for the 90s. So there's funk, rap, reggae, and some orchestral stuff. It's great because the quality is high, but my favorite stuff is the most symphonic sounding ones. Like the Snow Dungeon track is amazing because of its long loop that changes mood halfway through. Really creative. I like the boss track for its oppressive feeling. I like the general warm-up song for its sense of adventure. There's lots to love here. In the end, I'm gonna give Super Adventure Island 2 gets an 8 out of 10. Now, if only I could figure out why this guy looks like Super Mario, that would be swell. If you wanna see me play the games that I will review plus some extra stuff, catch me on Twitch at @ArachneRetro. It's my natural habitat, you see? Until next time, ciao ciao!